Cain or Bob Ross as our landscape painters. And I don't know if those names resonate for people, but Thomas Kincaid is called the painter of light in mass markets, landscape paintings in shopping malls across the country. And Bob Ross taught people of my parents' generation how to paint pretty little trees in their basements on Sundays, on the weekends. And so I think landscape fell out of fashion for that reason in our history. This is not really an academic hypothesis, which is more of a social observation. But I noticed that some great painters who I really admired were creating very interesting landscapes right around independence in India and for years after that. And these almost always had a political dimension, and I was really interested in showing them. But I feared that even though I was interested in landscape, that it would be hard to get the New York public to be as excited about these works as I was. So to remedy that, we invited 8 international contemporary artists who were working in some oblique way with landscape to actually create new work that responded to a specific modernist painting on view. And the results were really, I mean, if I can say so myself, they were really fantastic, and it was a great privilege to work with all of these incredible figures. And you can see, so this is the view of the exhibition, and I'll run through some of the comparisons. So you're now looking at Sudhir Gardens in the fall, which is about development in a Bombay suburb, and Lisi Raskin's After the Fall of 2012, which sought to create kind of the inside of a Bombay slum. From the outside looked like a Bombay slum, but on the inside was very posh and very comfortable, and a place that you wanted to sit and come and chill out. She decorated this home with war rugs created after 9/11 in Afghanistan for international markets, and then peppered the installation with toy soldiers, warplanes, and various other plastic tools of war, which people played with throughout the installation. And so, and of course, the fall and after the fall also has a 9/11 Twin Towers connotation. And so it was, I think, a really powerful way to connect the two works. And in fact, I like looking at them together because I think it works even better like this than it did in person in a certain sense, because you could see the painting and see the inside of the installation at the same time. So I'm glad to see it again. S.H. Raza is one of India's great modernists who worked primarily with landscape throughout his career. And he painted this work, Summer Blue, which looks vaguely like what Mark Rothko was known for, but slightly before Rothko was doing it. Raza was living in Paris at the time. And I took this painting as being a conventional landscape with a horizon line and a house or some such behind it. But there was a lot of blue and a big presence of sky in the work. So I asked the painter who I really admired, Byron Kim, if he would like to participate and basically continue a series of Sunday paintings for the exhibition. And the Sunday paintings are a series that he works on where every Sunday, no matter where he is in the world, he paints a little patch of the sky and writes a few lines of text about what's going on in his life at the time. And for him, this is about the relationship of the infinite, the sky, to the infinitesimal, or the everyday in his life. And so we showed four existing works and a fifth one that was painted on the roof of the Rubin Museum on December 2nd of 2012. And funnily enough, that day, the sky was like the same color as a primer's canvas. So he said, I was like, it's like a 10-minute Sunday painting. And he's like, yeah, we'll be in and out of here in no time. And just towards the end, as he was finishing up, this ray of light comes through, and he adapted the work for that context. And I asked him how he makes those decisions, and he said, actually, usually I would have skipped it, but since, this is about to go up, this seems part of this project, I wanted to be true to the exact moment that I painted this painting. And then he actually came back and said, I think your interpretation of this painting is wrong, I don't think nominating artists, I realized how heavily on artists, you know, for an understanding of how to look at art very often. So, Sahar Shah is a Pakistani-born American artist who has been working in landscape, and Ram Kumar is probably India's leading landscape artist. And Sahar had was working with, it was primarily a draft woman, and created these very complex, beautiful architectural drawings, and then took his trip to Chandigarh to see Le Corbusier's buildings there, and started creating photo collages based on that. And they actually made a nice pairing, the way that she dissected buildings in a kind of rectilinear way, and the way that Ram Kumar established a townscape by adding on buildings to each other, as we're seeing in the work at left. The most conceptual of all of these conceptual collaborations was Mark Handelman's Dimension Stone. And he's an artist who's well known for working with the conceptual elements of landscape. And when I approached him to create something for this show, he said, "What are the limits of what I can do?" And I said, give me what you got. And he said, "I want to hang one of the other paintings on one of my dimension stones. And I want it to be the case that you can't look at the modernist paintings and my paintings separately for the duration of the show. And then, you know, at the end of it, you can throw my work away. Like, my work only exists contingent to got the lender's permission, thought it was a great idea, and he proceeded to paint this trunk boy piece of pink pagoda marble, which was significant because it's a type of marble that's quarried in Rajasthan. And so he was actually creating a connection to something from the Indian landscape, something used in the Indian landscape, and body civilization. And then there were other theoretical dimensions to his work about marble and theory that was popular, especially in Nazi Germany, that you should build your cities so that when they're ruined by when they're raised 100,000 years later, they should still look good, and that marble is the right medium for that. And we had a wonderful talk with Mark in the galleries about that.
Did the collective keep marks?
No.
We
returned it to him. It had holes in it, actually, and he didn't care. I've never seen art handlers so nervous as watching them drill holes into a painter's work as that day. But you know, Mark insisted, and we went for it. Issa Greenfield Sanders works in a very systematic way, such that asking her to make a new work just didn't make sense. So I asked her to choose something. She the way that she works is she takes down photographs from the 50s and 60s of people in landscapes. And you know, she buys them on eBay at auction and country sales, things like that. And then she, by a process of transformation, winds up with a square canvas. She changes the color palette and changes basically everything about it except for certain formal compositional elements that are from the original photograph. So I asked her to choose one of her works and one of the works that were on my mom list for the exhibition, and to provide an explanation for why they fit together. And she showed